put off by how long this video is, don't worry, I try to jam-pack my videos with as much content and as much detail as I possibly can. Anything I feel I can comment on and that I feel you might be interested in, I pretty much put in the video. I try not to repeat myself and talk fairly fast. If the video is too long for you, I have recorded a shorter version and the link will be in the description box. Superman v. Batman, Dawn of Justice. V, not versus, because that matters somehow, 3D. The world is trying to figure out how it feels about Superman. Is he a deity, fallen or otherwise, false or otherwise? A boon, a bane, bada bing, bada boom. Batman has pretty much made up his mind. He is freaked out by Superman and remarkably paranoid. And I realize he is rather paranoid in the comics. But I'm going to get into this more, but this Batman, it takes, you know, there's, you can always talk about, someone probably has issues if they put on a costume and go beat up criminals. I think this Batman may need institutionalization, and I don't say that lightly, but yeah, I'll get more into that. Anyway, he, you know, he's quoting Dick Cheney. There's just, yeah, he's absolutely certain that Superman must be stopped. And obviously there will be a fight between them. And at the same time, might there be a greater danger? And is Lex Luthor planning something? I won't be giving away in this video whether or not this has more than one villain, like, you know, pretty much every single Batman movie. This, and, you know, failing that, the movie may just barely be about Batman. He may just be, you know, supporting character in the movie titled after him. In this, the police kind of treat Batman as, you know, I mean, it's not really quite, it's not exactly by the book, but they do maybe somewhat respect him, but, you know, technically they're supposed to, you know, try to take him in. Moving on to last minute notes. The movie is 2 hours and 25 minutes, not counting the end credits. And unless it's just like the Danish version, if, you know, if you hear something else, then obviously disregard. But in my version, there was nothing after the end credits, so no reason to stay through them. The opening establishes that Bruce Wayne was there in Metropolis during the climax of Man of Steel. He went in to, you know, help the people in his building. Because if they weren't working for him, then who cares? He went there in order to help anyone he could, to, you know, to at great personal risk of injury. And among others, he helps rescue a little girl who has absolutely no sense of self-preservation. And yeah, he you know, he does what he can to, Zack Snyder did some, yeah, he did this in Man of Steel as well. Dude really needs to get over his love of close-ups. I don't know what he thinks we gain from just, you know, I believe it's Rod of the editing room who pointed out that you could like practically count the nose hairs of the subject. It's just, it's incredibly distracting. It makes it harder to realize what you're seeing and how close it is to some to what other, you know, the other things that are in the immediate vicinity. And it's, yeah, just, I mean, there, it's not like, it's not every shot, and it's not every, like, there are tons of great shots in this, but it seems like he thinks that that's like, that's the golden one, you know. Every so often he's got to pull out when it's especially dramatic, when it's especially cool, bring in the close up. And it's just, it's, I don't think there was a single good close up in the film. But again, there's, you know, they're not, it's not constant. It's, you know, like, you know, it's, yeah, I think I've pretty much got it. Relatively early on in this, you start realizing that there are things in this that just, it feels like suddenly, so, you know, you're just not quite sure what you just saw. You know, it's not a ton of it, but just every so often, a handful of times in this film, there's a, what did I just see and why? I'm gonna be seeing an awful lot of bad things about this. I do want to say, Lex Luthor, the performance, I want to say Jesse Eisenberg is the name. As irritating as he is a bunch of the time, that is one great performance. You buy Lex, you are terrified of him, and you can see how, you know, he can convince people that are, like, one of the first things you know, you see, he's like, you know, he's this, you know, he's young money kind of thing. So he's got, like, he's playing basketball in his own building, you know, with some of the others. And then, you know, he shoots the hoop, and then, oh, hey, hi, Senator, handshake. And just, yeah, you know, I mean, if you were like 20 something and you had all the money in the world, are you telling me that you would not set up a sports kind of thing in, you know, yeah, in your own big expensive corporate building? Come on. If you can get away with it, you're gonna. And at times he seems nice, he seems sympathetic. But there's just, you know, spoiler alert, Lex Luthor is a bad guy. That literally, if you've never heard of Lex Luthor, it's clear from almost immediately in this that he is a bad guy. But yeah, it's, there's, and it's also like, sometimes when you see something like that, it's like, ah, oh, but, you know, that was amazing, but it should have been in a different movie, or he was in a different movie. It actually, it's one of the, I want to take this movie at face value. I want to take it on its own terms, even if that is, even if that means, like, not thinking critically about certain things. If you take it on its own terms, it is not a good movie, not even remotely. But there are elements that work, and chief among them is Lex Luthor. The very opening is the obligatory Batman origin. So, you know, I mean, you've seen bits of it in the trailers, and I was like hoping, just make it short, make it like a quick flashback, you know. When you watch Punisher Warzone, excuse me, there's a good chance you already know why Punisher is the Punisher. There's a brief flashback to why, and that's it. And that was kind of what I was hoping that they would do with Bruce Wayne's childhood tragedy in this. And I mean, they do the thing where they'll, like, you know, show Bruce's state of mind by, you know, showing us, you know, because we haven't gotten enough of that yet. Bruce flashing back to his parents being murdered. But the movie sees fit to open on the entire, like, and then the parents were murdered, and then he's, you know, with the at the, like, grave, and but he runs off because he's just so upset, and then the bats. And then comes the first indication that Bruce Wayne, this, who's, you know, alter ego Batman, may not be entirely well. But I'm gonna go more into that. Something I do think that this nicely, you know, this didn't really beat around the bush. Superman and Lois Lane are dating. That's, you know, you see that almost immediately, and it doesn't feel the need to do any kind of, because, you know, by the end of Man of Steel, I didn't buy the romance but you know, we're supposed to, and certainly in this, that they are together, and yeah, you know, it doesn't, like, The Amazing Spider-Man 2 starts with the you know, the two of them together, and then they break up not long after. And I want to say it was the last Angry Geek who pointed out the movie might as well have just started with them having already broken up. Yeah, this one doesn't waste any time on just, it's just almost immediately you are certain that the two of them are together. At the very start, Lois is basically trying to interview this, like, you know, terrorist leader, general guy, and just immediately, and this is never really answered, you're just like, why? Why is she right there? You know, I can understand, like, okay, she wants to know the guy's motives or whatever. That doesn't mean you put yourself in the line of fire. It's just, I mean, I have the greatest of sympathy for any real life journalist who have been taken by, but in this, it just, she just really comes across as, you know, well, I guess, you know, when you know that you're dating a superhuman, I guess you don't worry as much about your personal safety. But nevertheless, and, you know, and he delivers with these, you know, golden little lines about, oh, yeah, sure, I'm a terrorist, but you guys are using drones. And, you know, so, you know, it's Zack Snyder telling us, see, he's edgy, he gets it. There's, you know, oh, they actually think that we're the bad guys, get it? And Perry White did not have a personality in the first one, in Man of Steel. And that's really too bad, because Lawrence Fishburne is great. And in this, they give him personality. He's snarky and funny. And it's genuine, like he's, you see him as the actual, he's running this, the Daily Planet. He's making sure that they're cranking out enough stories. We know him as kind of busy. In this, you see him as busy, and yeah, he's like saying, okay, here's your headline, and then, Clark wants to run a negative story on, run a story on Batman, and there's a lot of crime, and Perry just says, crime bad in Gotham. In other news, water wet. So yeah, he's quite good in this, although he doesn't really have a lot else to do than snark headline suggestions and such, but it's a little bit more than the first one. They establish that there's this party at like with Lex, and Bruce Wayne is there, and Clark Kent is there, and the two meet face to face, of course, and immediately, I don't buy that these two people can make anybody believe that they're not their mad, their costumed alter ego, because they behave in almost the exact same way. They're just as aggressive and direct, and like Batman is really sharp and kind of, I mean, yeah, it's in the trailers, but just in case, you just, Clark is saying, to Bruce, both of them clearly know who the other is. Clark is saying to Bruce, don't you think this Bat Vigilante is going too far? Because he's Superman, he's upholding justice, and he tries not to go too far. And Bruce Wayne responds, don't you think you're being a little hypocritical because your newspaper is always like writing puff pieces about this incredibly dangerous, Superman character? And it's just, I realize that the two of them both know that the other, clearly they know that who the other one is. But even when you see them with anyone else, this is not an awkward and kind of, I mean, I don't need Clark to be like constantly stumbling and dropping things, and like, I feel that it's, we have gotten that in, most of the other Superman movies. So, if it's like, we don't really need that. I can understand that, and I don't, I'm not like crying betrayal, but Clark Kent here is basically the same as Superman. The difference between Clark Kent and Superman in this is that he's not clearly just about to do something. Like I mentioned in my Man of Steel review, I love Henry Cavill's Superman, and I thoroughly enjoyed getting that again in this. He really has both the charm and the weight of the world's problems on his shoulders. And when you see Henry Cavill as Superman, there is this sense that in a second he might have to do something, requiring a great feat of strength, to failing that great strength of feat, in order to save someone, in order to stop something horrible. But there's also this kind of thing of, you know, more in Man of Steel than in this, than of this thing of, you know, if I go and, you know, save someone or something, you know, will them realizing that I exist, that a superhuman exists, you know, will that, like, blow their, you know, little earthling minds? And yeah, I mean, when he's Clark Kent, when he's got the glasses on, he doesn't really have that. But other than that, it's the same basic, like, Clark Kent is, both Clark Kent and Superman are fairly naive, but with Clark Kent, there is this sort of, the naivete almost makes him seem kind of helpless, like other people almost have to take care of him, have to be, you know, you don't think that he could be Superman, you know, never minding the whole thing with the glasses and such. I'm not going to get into that right now. And Superman's naivete is this charming kind of, there is still hope out there, because someone who is that powerful is still that good, for lack of a better, yeah, that's, I actually do think that's, that quite fits, that someone that powerful is also that good, that he, you know, when he saves you from the, you know, crashing helicopter or such, he reminds you that flying is still one of the safest ways to travel. You know, it's not just the seriousness of the situation, the near-death experience that you've just been through is so thoroughly, it's, you know, it's not even like, are you okay? It's just, you are now safe. You are going to be okay. So I should add to that. You know, there is a, yeah, just, it's like, it's one of those, you know, it's one of those Smokey the Bear kind of, it's practically a slogan. It's like, you know, everything is fine now, so just, and it's just, here he's basically the same. And it's not, I mean, this Clark Kent isn't really, I mean, there are the glasses, but other than that, I mean, in the older films, they also gave, you know, they put him in suits where it's, he looked kind of silly, where, again, when you compare it to his, you know, the suit, him as, you know, Christopher Lee, rest in peace, as Superman, Christopher Reeves. I don't think Lee is dead yet, but he's also great. But Christopher Reeves as Superman, you know, where just, I mean, it takes a lot to wear bright colors in public and make it, you know, I mean, you really wouldn't think he'd have any dignity, but the man did. And then when he was Clark Kent, they put him in these suits that made it look, you know, but in this, I mean, he looks fine. I mean, if Henry Cavill wasn't playing Superman, if I saw him in a movie looking basically like he does as Clark Kent in this, I wouldn't think, what, I'm nothing of a person. He's just, okay, you know, the reason Clark Kent can hide is that you don't look at Clark Kent and think, I've never seen him and Superman in the same place. It's more that, oh, Clark, there you are. You missed Superman again. You're always, you know, it's that people underestimate and just, this Clark Kent, yeah, there's practically no difference. And this Bruce Wayne, I mean, I think there's once where he just briefly has to pretend to be, like, drunk, but I don't buy for a second that nobody is buying this guy as this playboy kind of thing, and just, yeah, it's, and we see various, various clips of people being interviewed, and, you know, talking about Superman and such. And they got poor Neil deGrasse Tyson to say, you know, oh, you know, we, you know, I mean, he's basically saying that, you know, obviously, you know, creationism is, you know, evolution has disproven creationism. We know that we, you know, Earth is not the center of the universe, and now there are aliens, and it's just, like with the first, like with Man of Steel, the movie clearly doesn't think it's like it's look at this cynical scientist ruining everything, making, you know, telling people what they have to think. At least they also get CNN Anderson Cooper, who is I'm not sure he ever does say Metropolis, but it would be, yeah, or Gotham for that matter. But just, yeah, I don't know. I have a little difficulty taking him seriously recently. What with the questions that he's asking the Republican questions that he's asking the Republicans, and then how he's treating the Democratic candidate. Yeah, just, yeah. This joins the, you know, this version of Batman has some things in common with the Nolanverse Batman, among others, that this, you know, the Batman can make people forget that they have guns. The senator who's supposedly a Democrat, that's hilarious. That's adorable. Seriously. She, you know, she tells someone that she, you know, I grew up on a farm. I'm used to wrestling pigs. Yeah. But are you gonna castrate any when you get to Capitol Hill? And that is more or less I'm not sure why Clark Kent has a job at the I mean, I know why Clark Kent has a job at the Daily Planet, but I don't know why how he manages to keep it, because he's never there, and everything he writes is shot down by Perry. So, yeah, not entirely sure why he keeps him around. The movie has surprisingly little action, especially of, like, there's very little of Superman and Batman. I'm not saying, like, you know, obviously they don't spend an awful lot of time actually fighting each other, but there's almost nothing of just Superman doing good and Batman, like, fighting crime or any, just, yeah. I figure that the 3D is a post-conversion, and I mean, there's a little bit showy, like, right as the film is starting, there are, like, you know, leaves blowing towards you and such, and, you know, that leads into Batman's origin, and there are some other things, but mostly it's just, you know, there's a little bit extra depth to some things, but not... If you're just looking for an answer to that question, no, the 3D is not worth it. The cameos are decent. It tends to be just, you know, a few seconds, and just, if you don't watch this movie but you want to know what the cameos are, they're gonna end up on, like, it's not like a lot of little, you know, interesting things. No, it's just, it's a few seconds for each that then, yeah, you could have cut these cameos entirely and they wouldn't have, yeah. There's some dialogue that's really awkward and some terrible one-liners. The climax is quite cool, and I will say that unlike Man of Steel, this isn't just like, you know, in Man of Steel is basically the whole third of that movie is basically the climax. In this, it's much more, yeah, it's less of the film, and it, you know, it is thus more focused. The actual fight between Batman and Superman, it's okay. If it's like the pass-fail kind of thing, you know, and you're looking, maybe you want to watch this movie, but you want to know, is the Batman versus Superman fight worth it? No. And that appears to be it. It has been pointed out before, especially by the Nostalgia Critic and his kin, Batman and Superman, as you know, yeah, the Man of Steel Superman and Batman are just far too similar. You know, you've got the dark background, the kind of lonely thing, you know, having lost parents and such, where that's, you know, again, for people who maybe don't remember Superman before Man of Steel, Superman was not really lonely. I mean, yeah, you could have stories like that, but he took such pride, and he was so happy to be able to help, to inspire hope, that it wasn't really this big broody kind of thing. And yeah, the you know, his background really wasn't that, you know, I mean, in theory, it's incredibly dark, you know, lost his entire home planet, he will never know his own people and such, but that wasn't really, again, there are different versions of Superman, but traditionally Superman, it's just that's why there's only the one, basically. It's kind of just that, you know, and that's why he's here, but he's so different from us, and why he's not leaving. You know, that's basically it. And once he is here on Earth, then, yeah, it's all about he tries to help. And to be fair, you know, Man of Steel, Superman, you know, you weren't entirely sure where he was going. In this, it is very clear he is doing what he can to help people, and you know, it is this thing of, like, you know, PR kind of, he's always doing what he can to help people, to, you know, the when he goes after someone, it's not like with, where it's, you know, with Batman, it's like, you know, the he does what the police maybe won't or something, you know, and some say what he does is, you know, he goes too far and such. And with Superman, it's very much, yeah, if he goes after someone, it's pretty clear that this, you know, this is someone who deserves to be, to, yeah. And the This is based in part on the comic classic, Frank Miller's The Dark Knight Returns. So was The Dark Knight Rises. That did a better job. It was a far better movie. I know not everybody loves it, and I can understand. I can see the problems with it. I still love it. But I think it'll... Yeah, I don't think there will be much... This movie is not going to have as many defenders as... Yeah, as many apologists, as it were. And, yeah, that movie just did a much better job of making that work within the... Yeah. But... And the... You know, we of course have, you know, this... We're starting over with a new Batman, and... Even though I honestly don't really see why they didn't just say, you know, I mean, I get it's not connected to the Nolanverse, but even if you don't, you know, use that continuity, why not start with a Robin or Nightwing, you know? But we've had so much Batman, and I mean, I'm not saying that we shouldn't have more Batman, but I am saying, if you're going to give us another Batman, do something different with it. And certainly don't copy the same exact... I mean, we have an aged Batman who, you know, he retired, and now, you know, for, you know, years on end, and now he's coming back. And there's this sort of one mission kind of thing, and that is right out of the comic, but that was also in The Dark Knight Rises, and in that it felt earned. In this, it just, I mean, there's technically a reason why this Batman took a break. I'm not going to give it away, but it is there, but it's mostly just set up for another, like, it doesn't, in the comic, there's a nice little kind of mirroring of why Batman retired and what happens when he comes back. And yeah, in this, there's just not, you know, and Dark Knight Rises actually toys a little with an element like that, and this one just really doesn't at all. The if they didn't know that they were getting more movies, excuse me, about this continuity Batman, and it wasn't involving such a beloved character, then the reason for his retirement in this would be, you know, it could be anything else. It's there because they're sequel baiting. And yeah, the where in the comic it's very much, you know, there's the crime has kept just, you know, getting increasingly worse, and, you know, he's back to try to, yeah, to fight that again, you know. And this, it's, you know, basically he's more or less back to stop Superman. And this does then not have the, you know, just, you know, extremely brutalized youth criminals. You know, this really doesn't have that much of Batman fighting criminals as Batman. It really didn't need to. Yeah, anyway. And the So we have a Justice League of America, JLA, which will start with this, 50-something-year-old Batman, and presumably he'll be replaced by Robin or, the like, not too far down the line, which, again, I feel like they should just have jumped to a Robin. That, even if it wouldn't be the Nolan verse, I can understand if some people don't really want to see. I thought he did fine, but yeah, if you've watched the movie, you know who I'm talking about. And if not, then I don't want to spoil it. But yeah, and it's honestly. They've been trying to launch the DCU for a while now, and Man of Steel was the one that really started a set continuity that the ones are gonna, that they're all going to fit into, because Green Lantern certainly didn't work out. And when I reviewed Man of Steel, I said that I did want to see more of Henry Cavill Superman. I certainly still do. And that, I could see how it could lead to more of these. Having now watched this, I can see where they want to kind of go with, how they're going to go about. Certainly assembling the JLA, which, yeah, if you've seen the list of cameos for this one, then some of the main members. And if not, then you probably don't care yet, if you haven't looked up which ones. I don't want it to fail. Because I do think that some of the casting and yeah, I like some of the decisions. I would like to see where the but I can imagine that people are going to hate this movie. Man of Steel did have some defenders. I'm not sure how many people are going to stand up for this one. I could be wrong, but I really think that Zack Snyder made some huge missteps in this, given that it's still not for sure that, I mean, they have plans, they have contracts and whatnot, but it's not completely sold yet. It's still on a movie by movie basis. The MCU was, was more of a sure thing. Each movie was like, oh man, this is really good. Yeah, Iron Man 2 is no good, but even some of the others, okay, the Thor movies are, not amazing, but there was still this sense, this is, people liked them enough, and they didn't make a lot of mistakes as far as creating building a world where all these heroes could coexist. And yeah, this one makes several really big mistakes that I'm not gonna spoil in this, but just if you're wondering whether or not you should watch it and you don't want to see them make huge mistake, then do not watch this. And Yeah. And definitely also avoid spoilers because there are going to be some huge ones. There are some things in this that are going to be shouted about. And yeah. You really would have thought that he learned from Man of Steel because he actually does. He's learned some things from Man of Steel. There are some things that Zack Snyder does less in this that, clearly really bother people. Like I said, Superman is more straightforward of a, like, when you see Superman in this, it is like this is one of the good guys, and you want to see him, Yeah, and you see him like doing good, and there's the, you see him do a lot of heroic things in Man of Steel, but it's often this kind of thing where he's not wearing the suit. And it's like, he does this thing, but then he has to go hide because, obviously the things that are going to be said about him, and in this, it's instead, because that suit does make a huge difference. In this, whenever people see when they see the suit, they know I'm saved. I'm safe. It's going to work out. He is a symbol. He is someone who inspires, and which that's what we want when we watch a Superman movie. Even if we, you can play around with elements, which Man of Steel did, but at the end of the day, we want to be able to look at Superman and, be like, that's a hero. That's someone that. Now, the. This does do a decent enough job of making Batman. You can tell him different, to tell him apart, rather, from the other. I mean, we've had quite a few Batmans at this point. Although the basic continuity, the first four are technically the same continuity, but there's also three different actors in the cape and cowl. I would say, so when you in 2016 come out with a Batman movie, given that we've had Batman movies, Batman has been in a movie fairly consistently since 89. There was a gap there between 97 and 2005. We all know why. That was about it. Other than that, there's only been a few years between each. So again, kind of risking oversaturation, and I'm not saying I don't want Batman, because obviously I do. I wouldn't be recording this video if I didn't want Batman. I wouldn't go to every single one of these movies if I did not want Batman. But you do have to do something different with it, and I do think that I like Ben Affleck's Batman, I will say that. And I don't hate his Bruce Wayne, I just think it's way too similar to his Batman. But they do take some elements from the comic, from Dark Knight Returns, that Dark Knight Rises did not, and that haven't really, that we haven't really seen before. And I do think, yeah, some of that really does work out quite nicely. And as the trailers have pretty much told you, yeah, the movie's ridiculously bloated. I mean, at the end, once you've watched almost the entire thing, excuse me, a lot of the things fall into place and you end up with something that you can pretty much follow what goes on. It pretty much does all go together, by the end of it, at the end of the day. But yeah, along the way, there's just a lot of elements that don't really feel like they're going to, and things you don't really get that into. I'd say Batman's effect, it almost feels more like it's there for Superman's reaction to it, because it doesn't spend a lot of time on, you know, there are some great visuals, there are a few really cool scenes about Batman being Batman and his effect on people, but it doesn't really go anywhere. It doesn't feel like the big thing of the film is the conflict between these two, and yeah, some of Batman being there almost just feels like it's there so that Superman can react to it. I feel like there are parts of the movie, it's like Zack Snyder went to work and he's like, man, I love Superman. And then he went to work other days, man, I love Batman. And it doesn't really fully gel at the end of the day. The different elements from the different... yeah. You know, there's far too much plot, there are too many plot points, there are far too many things that this film even has to introduce and then actually work with. Like I said, the reason Batman was, I mean, it's one thing that Batman, you know, Batman is now part of the universe of Man of Steel, but apparently he was for a while, and then he took a break, and now he's back. And back then, there was something, and then that changed, and that's why he took a break. Now he's back. And the reason that he took a break is kind of still hanging in the air, because there are going to be more movies in this continuity. And that's... If the movie could have just had... I mean, heck, the first movie could have had a hint. The first movie hinted that Lex Luthor was out there. But, yeah, Batman, you know, we have to have him introduced. We have to have his origin. We have to have... yeah. And, you know, in the trailers, you also see Batman, you know, he's fighting in this kind of, you know, in like a broken down building, and like he breaks through to fight them, and this, you know, and that works well, and that is also right out of the comic. And it's something right on the comic that fits here. And the, you know, of course, we have Katrina imagery with Superman doing heck of a job, Supes. And, you know, some Middle East warfare kind of stuff, obviously from a conservative, hawkish point of view. This doesn't really do a Dark Knight Rises kind of ridiculous misrepresentation of a political movement. And the ridiculous collateral damage of the Man of Steel climax is in part addressed here. You know, that is part of why Bruce Wayne and Batman have a problem with Superman. You know, recently rewatching it, I realized the military does do a ton of collateral damage as well. They're literally attacking inside Metropolis when there's still a ton of people around. And I don't hear that get brought up as often, which I don't know if that's because we're almost numb to the idea that our military kill people who shouldn't die, or yeah, but anyway, it is addressed here some, but then there's also more of this kind of collateral damage. And in this, Superman does try to, you know, avoid You know, he's not going to do something extremely dangerous when there's a lot of people around. But, you know, in the first portion of the film where, you know, where we see Bruce Wayne during the climax of Man of Steel, we of course get more of the 9/11 porn and already mentioned the Katrina. You know, I'm not sure if the space vessel one that you also see in the trailers, that might also be one of the, it certainly does resemble. Yeah, I think again they're doing, you know, why settle for 9/11 porn when you can porn so many other major disasters in US history and recent memory? But yeah, the and it's, you know, the it's distinctly different from the Superman Returns space shuttle portion, where it's, you know, Superman Returns is basically trying to be Superman the movie again. So there is, you know, even when it's incredibly dangerous, it's never like that dark in you know, the way it's presented. But of course, you know, really big disasters and such happen so that Superman can be saving people, because if, you know, if they didn't, what exactly would he do? I guess he'd be flying around saving cats out of trees, but yeah. The script was written by the scriptwriter of Argo and David Goyer. David Goyer wrote Man of Steel with Christopher Nolan, who here only executive produces. And for research for watching and reviewing this, I read for the first time the comic Dark Knight Returns. I watched the six other Superman movies, seven other Batman movies, including the awesome riff tracks of The Dark Knight, 300, Daredevil, and Watchmen. The things I do for the sake of reviews. I mean, other than Nolan, man, there's a lot of bad between these two characters in their film adaptations. I probably will not be reviewing any of the older films, only future ones. I mentioned that Lois and Superman are together. That does also mean that almost the first thing you see of Lois in this is she's in a bathtub, and then he comes in, and then they do the romantic gesture of him getting in there, even the, you know, fully dressed and the whole, and it's, I guess for the ladies, I have no problem with that. I just, it's very incongruous with the rest of the film, because it's, this really isn't a film for, like, you know, it doesn't really, you know, it's not trying to attract young women who just really want to swoon over, you know, Henry Cavill, a Superman. Like I already mentioned, there's not that much of him in this. The various characters are quite psychologically realistic, and this is, you know, this is fairly deep as far as our protagonists goes, what drives them. And like I said in my Man of Steel review, you know, Henry Cavill is my favorite Superman in a long time. And in this, you do see that Superman is not. He doesn't want to have to kill, at least. And he still is some, has this thing of, should I go out there? Should I be, there's still, in the first one, excuse me, it was basically whether to reveal himself, whether to, excuse me, like permanently become part of the world as someone who tries to save people. And in this, he is doing that most of the time, but there is still some conflict. And, this doesn't really have any, neither Batman nor any of the villains or the like really do any silly voices. This is Zack Snyder was the man who had Rorschach, do the Batbale voice, and yeah, the one thing with this Batman is he seems to use this kind of voice, like, some voice modulator kind of thing where his voice doesn't sound quite the same, which makes sense for, so that nobody is like, wait, you sound just like Bruce Wayne. And that's a decent enough, idea, has been explored otherwise elsewhere, of course. And yeah, it works fine for the film. And from what I hear of it's called the social network, I think, the Facebook movie, Jesse Eisenberg can, the way he played the Facebook founder in that really made, made sense for him to be in this. And, haven't watched that, so I don't know how the performances compare, but certainly, yeah, I buy him as this Lex Luthor. And this Lex Luthor, yeah, I've already gone a little into the, it has been pointed out elsewhere that he, comes off as Jim Carrey's the Riddler in the trailers. That really is not, they should maybe have chosen some other parts of his performance, because those really do. I mean, yeah, those bits are in the film, but you don't get the sense of him being like that. Yeah, they fit in the film. It's just when you when it's all you've seen of his performance, you maybe think, is he gonna be like that the whole movie? And he really isn't. He's really, really compelling. And no, he is not bald in this, and I found it quite, it didn't bother me too much. There aren't a lot of people who look good bald, and it's also, how it where it places itself as far as, you know, realism goes and such. And he is convincing as this kind of, you know, brilliant businessman. And, you know, again, we the viewer can tell that he's a villain, but, you know, you can basically believe that, you know, especially before Superman, it's very clear that he's been behaving very differently. And, you know, yeah, since Superman arrived. And in, yeah, it quite works. And with Lex Luthor, you know, it's of course also this thing of, like, you know, could he be stopped? You know, being that he is just a human being, could he be stopped by, for example, the military and such? And this does, yeah, let's just say that there's something for Superman to deal with in this, yeah. And, you know, much like Zod was in the first, and, you know, Nolan's villains also required, you know, they required Batman. This does not really go much into, you know, in the first we got a lot of Jor-El, in this, not really. I mean, in Man of Steel, Jor-El is trolling so hard, I practically expected him to name his son Ello instead of Cal. And Lois is still, she has a little bit more of a point in this one. She's not completely pointless. The romance is, but, and it's, again, they, I don't know why they give Amy Adams so little to do in these, because she is so talented, and, yeah, but I am grateful that it's not the, you know, obnoxious kind of constantly talking Lois Lane of the, you know, yeah. And, you know, this is still a film where, you know, some of the female characters are very strong and, you know, yeah, that, you know, you don't, you know, they, and she does have some stuff to do. And I'm pretty sure I saw that Jimmy Olsen was going to be in this, which, you know, people were like freaked out about, oh, did they really gender swap Jimmy Olsen to Jenny Olsen? Jenny is in this, but she is not, her last name is not Olsen, I'm pretty sure. I'm not sure I did see Jimmy Olsen in this, though, but I may have just missed him. This is a pretty good Alfred. You know, the first four, good Alfred. The Nolan trilogy had a great Alfred. Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, for one thing, obviously, it's difficult to top Michael Caine. And also, obviously, it's Jeremy Irons. Of course, he's going to be at least good. And the dynamic between them is also, you know, quite, Alfred in this is very much this kind of, like, he really hopes that Bruce will just try to actually have a normal life. You know, he's like, you know, go to the pot. See if you can't find a young woman to make you honest. Oh, who am I kidding? He's quite good. And he is right there in, like, you know, he's right there in the Batcave. He is working on the equipment and he is helping him out from the control room and everything. So, very active role in that. Even in the trailers, you hear Martha Kent say to Superman, "You don't owe this world a thing you never did." That just really, I guess because he wasn't born here, but he came here as an infant. You know, we fed him, clothed him, and sustained him for his entire life. If we're talking about, you know, someone who doesn't owe society anything, Zod didn't, because he, you know, he just came to Earth, so he didn't, you know, owe Earth anything for taking care of. But, you know, I get that it's like, you know, conservative perspective and such, but seriously, that is Ayn Rand levels of nobody matters but me right there. Gina Malone was apparently cast as Batgirl, well, as Barbara. I'm not certain if she was also, you know, she's not always Batgirl, but, you know, that was like cut and put on the R-rated DVD. I gotta watch that because I can totally see Gina Malone as, yeah. Where Man of Steel has this kind of thing of, like, constant big dramatic events, things, you know, blowing up and big dangerous things happening that Superman has to stop the danger, you know, with, yeah, this one doesn't really do that. It doesn't, yeah, the structure isn't like that. And like I said, it's not, you know, it's not the last third of the film that's just like one big climax or something. It's, and the movie definitely doesn't have too much action. I would almost, I've more or less almost already said, but yeah, I don't think it has enough. We don't get enough of the two titular heroes doing what they do, what we're there to see them do. But the action, you know, sometimes moves too fast and it's hard to follow, you know, and with that said, you know, this, unlike Man of Steel, there really isn't an action scene in this that, like, completely, that you could just completely remove and it wouldn't really, or action scenes that should have been combined or the like. And like Man of Steel, no singular action scene is too long. There's always breathing room in between action scenes. And this does do a lot to capture the distinct elements of both titular heroes, the way they fight, their abilities, their strategies, their approach to situations. And, you know, I kind of already went into whether it's a Superman movie with Batman, vice versa, or a movie giving equal time to both. You know, it's, I wish I could say that it, you know, that as a Superman film, it's good, because boy, would it be nice to have a good Superman movie, even just a movie with Superman that was good as a Superman movie, you know, other than the 78 one. And the, you know, given that it's a Superman movie, of course, Lex Luthor is the villain. I rewatched like the various channel some some of their videos on thoughts of Man of Steel, and I believe Spoonie back when it came out pointed out that Zack Snyder probably had to promise them Lex Luthor will be in the next one in order to get and that Zod would be, because that's that's what people know. And yeah, and the there are some some fanatical supporters of the villain, like the entire Nolan trilogy. I personally find this Superman suit to be fine. I think it's close enough to the the classic and the widely accepted look, and also just it changes just enough so it doesn't seem silly. It and the bat symbol is quite good, and I like the various bat suits in this. The there are for a couple of different situations, and given that the regular bat suit is cloth with without armor, they wanted it to be that this Batman is effective because he is strong and such a good fighter. Which thankfully does not mean that he fights a superhuman without any armor, but it does mean that he could get shot by any random person, which, like I already said, people forget that their guns shoot. His fighting style is more, aggressive and acrobatic, which is quite like the com compared to what we've seen before in the films, which is quite like the comics and the Arkham video games. However, given that this is in part based on the, Dark Knight Returns, this. In both of these, we have an aged Batman, and in that, he has some problems fighting because he's out of practice, and sometimes he gets really lucky, sometimes he almost fails, almost dies. The Batman of Dark Knight Returns is a lot like Frank Miller's other work, Sin City's Detective Hardigan. He has this one last mission and he doesn't really care about what comes after. He is, his killing days are almost over as an over-the-hill do-gooder, son of a female dog. Where, I don't, I like that we get that we now have a Batman who, fights real good, but I don't think Zack Snyder really. I don't think he nails things down as what makes, and just works from that. I think he has a list of things that he thinks are cool, and then he puts them all in the movie, even if some of them clearly contradict one another. And yeah, that's definitely an issue here, because I like the idea of an aged Batman, especially as played by, I mean, a lot of people complained when they saw that it would be Ben Affleck. And I understand, and if you've watched Daredevil and you thought he was bad in that, and you're thinking, will he be bad in this as well? I would say he isn't. I would say in this he does better in this than he did in Daredevil. But no, I don't think he did particularly bad in Daredevil, but nevertheless, he just he's a good actor. He can, you buy that there is that weight of all these, all these years and all these battles, which, I thought that Bale did a great job in Dark Knight Rises, and in general, I like him as, but yeah, but I don't think Zach realized that if you also have an aged, kind of out of practice one, then he can't be fighting in, And, in Dark Knight Returns, he fights without, it's a cloth costume. It's not really armored. That is also actually addressed, although it does, it's not completely ignored in this. And the... when the two fight, you do feel like, like someone, like one of them could win by killing the other. And the Ben Affleck really bulked up for this, and then that's, of course, that's we expect that of people who play costumed heroes today, but he is huge and bigger than Superman is in the, and he can actually use the suit while fighting. They don't have to do any trickery, and it's, and that is also very appropriate to The Dark Knight Returns, and now, like in Dark Knight Returns, he does use gadgets, he realizes that some of what he has that Superman doesn't is, these various gadgets, and he can plan things that can maybe do serious harm to Superman, or, where death of a thousand, what is it? Cuts, death of a thousand cuts. He can keep wearing Superman down. And he may not be completely averse to the use of guns, but he isn't running around with guns either. And, the Batmobile is this kind of, it's, again, we just had the Tumbler, so it, of course, has to, it is not the insane and awesome tank that it is in the comic, but it is cool, and they did a good job of, something that makes sense, that, the Tumbler made sense, and this one makes sense. It's something that Batman would get and would use, and we do get to see it in action, at least some. So, And, the Batwing also, at least a little bit, we see. And this one doesn't really, there aren't too many effect shots and such, it doesn't feel like, well, they had some extra money, so they threw in an effect or made something bigger because they could. And unlike Man of Steel, this doesn't really do handheld, so the handheld and 3D don't cancel each other out. It's, Just that the 3D is just only okay. And, you know, this is a PG-13, and as a lot of recent action movies, it really pushes the PG-13 with some really messed up stuff that you wouldn't have thought that they would be able to do on a PG-13. The various themes and subplots, like with Man of Steel, you know, they're brought up and then there's not really anything done with it, you know. I mean, ultimately we know that, you know, it's right there in the title, Dawn of Justice. We know that this is leading to the Justice League, and I mean, this does bring up the idea of a Justice League or something like it, but yeah, it just doesn't. And again, I don't. It could have. It could very well have. Anyway. And, you know, unlike Man of Steel, you know, Man of Steel very much tried to be Batman Begins with, you know, all these flashbacks and they're out of order and can kind of ruin the effect and such. And this doesn't really jump back and forth very much. It's largely linear. And, you know, Snyder does get, you know, build up of, you know, and he does have a keen sense of visuals, but ultimately he is only as good as his script. And yeah, that's something you very much tell. I mean, I did not subject myself to Sucker Punch again, but when you do look at his movies, he did a really great job on 300. He really did. And that's because ultimately that's a very simple concept. And it's, if you understand it, and it's fairly simple, easy to understand. So he did. And it's, you know, it's hypermasculinity. It's toxic masculinity treated as a positive, and this kind of, you know, just, and Zack Snyder gets that, you know, so he did a fantastic job there. But then, you know, Watchmen and Sucker Punch, just, yeah. And here again, I mean, it, you can tell during when something exciting is going on, he knows how to make it work. We are excited when we see Superman save someone, which, you know, there are a lot of just brief, you know, you see some of the stuff you see in the trailers, those aren't full scenes. Those are just brief little, you know, there's, I guess maybe he's trying to kind of do the, you know, in The Dark Knight Returns, Miller did a lot of satire on the media, on, you know, public figures and just, you know, regular people just reacting to, you know, talking about Batman. And in this, they kind of do that with Superman. And yeah, and for some of that, we just briefly see Superman doing something heroic where, you know, I mean, at least in Man of Steel, there would be a scene. It wasn't just that you saw, yeah. It's entirely possible that this movie was supposed to be a lot longer and was cut down because they had too much. And thus we end up, you know, because that's something that happens today in comic book movies. Some scenes end up too long and they just, you know, make it a, you know, maybe it's a training video or a, you know, video showing how something would look or the like. And this does kind of do the origin story for Batman, not otherwise, really, for any character. And there is, of course, not an awful lot of color, but I would say that the costumes and their, you know, and the gadgets and such, and their effects, they do, you know, yeah, the it's, there's enough color for that, basically, but, you know, the current dark, gritty style is, of course, does not allow for a lot of color, and we are still suffering some PTSD from the Joel Schumacher nightmare neon. Yeah. And this doesn't really have goofy designs and phallic imagery. That was pretty much all Kryptonian stuff in Man of Steel, so they're basically done with that. I should say also, you know, people pointed out that as of the climax of Man of Steel, you know, what happened about the, you know, there were these huge, you know, Kryptonian, you know, all this Kryptonian technology over Metropolis, and then what? Nothing afterwards. In this, one of the Kryptonian ships actually crashed, and it's been there. This, I believe this takes place 18 months after, or at least starts 18 months after Man of Steel, and yeah, they just had to kind of leave the ship there, because, you know, how do you move something like that in the cities, right? So, you know, it's not all entirely without consequence. And I already mentioned that this Batman, you know, there might be some, there might be some mental issues there. I don't think it's a problem for one of your protagonists to be possibly, like, Steve Shives just did a video about Batman and Superman where he points out that Superman is an enabler to Batman. Batman clearly needs help, and Superman keeps telling him, nope, you just put that costume on and let's go fight crime. And that's you can have that could be an interesting character, but a lot of the time this Batman isn't. We're maybe a little scared of him, of what he might do. And Batman can turn into a bit of a sociopath in the wrong hands, or the right hands, depending on your point of view. When Zack Snyder adapted Watchmen, he had interpreted Rorschach as the hero rather than this really dangerous sociopath that, and yeah, here it's some of the same. I don't think he realizes that this Batman is like, I mean, it's one thing that Superman thinks that he is, you know, he's maybe going too far. And so I'm legitimately not sure that. Yeah, he seems dangerous and really, really close to just completely snapping. And yeah, of course, you know, Snyder also famously made the villain very obviously gay and made the movie a lot gorier than the book was. The when I first heard that this was going to be a versus, you know, my initial thought was, why not go for the world's finest kind of thing? I get that, you know, don't do a JLA movie right away. You know, now you have a Superman movie, maybe bring in Batman, you know, and that instead of doing a Batman movie, they wanted to hold on to Superman because, oh, wow, one of them actually made it. One of them did well. So next, let's bring in another one, but we don't want to let go of Superman because then we risk messing it up and risk people not wanting to go. And I get the thing of, like, you know, you know, if you have two heroes fighting each other, then that might, you know, really get people interested. But yeah, they could have just had the two be on the same side. You know, have this kind of, you know, you can still use the fact that they're very different people and have very different perspectives. You know, I mean, maybe you have already watched the trailer on YouTube called World's Finest. I'm not saying it's amazing, but, and I'm not saying that what it shows should be turned into a movie, because, you know, some of what's in that trailer, we did, you know, Two-Face in that trailer. We had a really great Two-Face. We don't need to try to do another, you know, Aaron Eckhart one, not the Tommy Lee Jones trying to play Jack Nicholson's The Joker, Two-Face. But the basic idea there with, you know, some of the enemies, you know, an enemy of both of them and, you know, one of Superman's enemies, one of Batman's enemies teaming up, and then the two heroes also having to team up and work together. I feel like that could have worked quite well. And, you know, if you are watching, like, old independent trailers for, you know, fan-made trailers for movies based on these DCU characters, definitely treat yourself to Grayson. And that one, I mean, obviously there's enough material there to make an entire series, but if they, you know, that one also has the thing of, you know, okay, Batman's gone, so how about Robin? Just some of the ideas in there could be quite, yeah, could really work for, yeah, this. Now, when the, and this is again, this, you know, not a spoiler, and in the trailers and such, some of the people against Superman yell, "Go home." I feel like there's really, you know, isn't that treating Superman kind of like a Syrian refugee? But I don't know. And I do, you know, one thing about this that, you know, even with Ben Affleck in this, at least Jennifer Garner isn't in it. You know, Jennifer Garner, God himself did not want Jennifer Garner in this movie. He was so determined, he made a kid sick. Then he threw it out of a tree, healed it from that, had the mom write a book, had the book made into a movie, cast Jennifer Garner just to make sure that she was not in this movie. And personally, I still think she did fine, Daredevil. I mean, it wasn't Alias level, but nevertheless. I believe I've covered everything. I don't know. I guess, you know, if you still think, you know, sure, you could go watch it, but yeah, at the end of the day, it is pure SS piece of hope. I've reviewed other parts of this franchise, the links are in the description box. Please comment, thumbs up, and subscribe for more content.